One of the things that was clear to us from day one back in 1962 was that if Atlantic College was to be the only one, the project was not worthwhile. I'm leaving here this summer to take up the headship of the new college of the Adriatic. And it's a very great thing for us now to look at the world map and see six spots, six United World Colleges, and how many more in the years to come.
I had the great excitement of being present at the opening of Atlantic College, and it's an unusual opportunity to be in at the start of another new college.
Welcome, everybody. It is such a privilege to be here with all of you today to celebrate my brilliant uncle, David Sutcliffe. I have a very quick note of housekeeping before we get started. Your default setting on this call is that you're muted. Please keep it that way. We have more than 800 people registered, and we just want to avoid any kind of troubleshooting with sound. There will be an opportunity to socialize at the end of this formal event. We will keep the Zoom meeting open if you want to hang around and reconnect with old friends. You can even put your college affiliation with your name in the Zoom meeting if you want to sort of figure out who's around. It's kind of the pandemic edition of the reception after the speeches. So feel free to hang around after the final slideshow. David influenced the lives of everyone speaking and performing today, and hundreds more listening in. Without David, I wouldn't be who I am. I would never have heard of, let alone applied to the United World College. I wouldn't have met my husband, who went to the UWC the same year as I did. And I almost certainly would not have become a foreign correspondent for an international newspaper. It was in New Mexico that I started to think about the world in terms of stories. The world in terms of stories of my friends. I learned about the Middle East from Yael, whose maternal grandparents were Greek Holocaust survivors, and from Abdullah, who lost family in the Nakba. I experienced the outbreak of war in Yugoslavia in real time with Jovan, whose parents were stuck in Belgrade at the time. And it was at the UWC that I made my first East German and my first Jewish German friend, understanding my own country in a much more complete way than ever before. David believed in the power of education and friendship to inoculate the world against war. He was not yet five and on a boat off the coast of Guernsey with his father when Chamberlain announced that Germany and Britain were at war. He never forgot that moment. It was a memory that would propel him on a lifelong mission to foster international understanding. He took this mission terribly seriously before he ever headed or founded a UWC. He went to marry a German. Now, David's courtship of Elizabeth didn't always go so well. Once, Elizabeth had broken her leg skiing and was staying at her parents' house in Tübingen. David paid her a surprise visit and they basically went out for lunch, driving my grandparents' car. My dad, Elizabeth's younger brother, who was a student at the time, saw his parents' car parked in the center of town, coincidentally across the street from the police station. He knew that my grandparents were away and that Elizabeth couldn't drive because of her leg. So he immediately reported the car stolen to the police. It wasn't the best start with his future German in-laws, but great practice for building international understanding. And then in 1962, 1 year after they were married, David and Elizabeth went on their first United World College adventure to the newly founded Atlantic College. And one of the first students to attend the college just 5 years later was Jorma Ollila. You all know his name. We all had a Nokia phone once before the iPhone came along. Jorma is the former CEO of Nokia, but in 1967, he was a Finnish teenager who grew up 5 hours south of the Arctic Circle and had never left his country. And then he got that scholarship to the UWC. And it was at AC that Jorma met an energetic young deputy headmaster who would help him make a decision that turned out to be pretty life-changing. Jorma, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Catherine. Dear Elizabeth, dear friends and colleagues, it's great to join this event. I have this long association with the UWC, having arrived in the Atlantic College in September 1967. Naturally, when I arrived, my housemaster was the first staff person that I got into a discussion with, but it was really the meeting with David Sutcliffe that made the mark in one of the first days upon arrival. I met him early because he had just started as the director of studies and the deputy headmaster in the Atlantic College. His instructive and supportive guidance for me in deciding what my A-level subjects, the key three subjects might be. It was his guidance that eased out my early nervousness. He even actively supported me when I went to see him again to make a revisit only 1 month later and told him that I wanted to switch chemistry, which I had picked as one of my subjects, to be economics. David, I was forewarned that this is not a given acceptance, but David, who is a great educationalist, is at his best in this area, in working with students on one-on-one situations like this. And it was a good discussion with him. I was many times impressed with the way in which he was able to combine two things: his organized and disciplined way of working and analyzing things on one hand, and his disarmingly friendly way of discussing and solving issues. Just one example. Years later, after I had left the college, I commented him that I was happy he gave me a chance to switch my A-level subject to economics in the college. He laughed and said that how could he have done otherwise after I had made such a determined, even almost stubborn case like you Finns often do. My comment, coming with a smile, was that perhaps this is a recipe for survival. And he added that, responded, "Do you mean for you or for your country?" So we both laughed. This was again a demonstration from David of his deep understanding of how the human mind and how the world works. So no further comment was needed at that point of situation. During my 2 years in the Atlantic College, David was also my teacher in German. And since I was in the inshore lifeboat service, we met regularly in the waterfront, David being the head of the rescue boats after he had run the beach rescue for a number of years. He had taken it over in 67 when I came in. But his impact really, in my view at the time, was on academic life in the college, and it was a formidable impact. Our year, the 1967 entry, not only completed the A-level exams, and I think we did quite well, after 2 years of hard work, but we also did a trial run on the International Baccalaureate, the IB. This was to develop the exam, which then later became the UWC core exam and a strong international exam for millions just before entering the university. But not only this, during the second year in December, we completed not only the US who were willing. We completed the US SAT exams in subjects relevant to each of us. We felt this was quite a lot. But in hindsight, it was not only good for the UWC academic development, but also trained all of us exceptionally well for final A-level exams. This simply shows how David never left a stone unturned in making sure he can develop things long-term and simultaneously assist his students at the time. My time in the college coincided with many dramatic world events. On August 20, 1968, we were as second year students in our August period, when the whole of Europe woke up that morning with the news of the Soviet tanks rolling into Prague in Czechoslovakia. When I arrived early in the morning into the dining hall in the castle, the two Czech students had taken their radio with them, and everybody listened to BBC World Service in total silence over breakfast for more than half an hour before we dashed into morning classes. That week, David Sutcliffe took a great educationalist role here again and facilitated many, many discussions in different forums and tried to make sure that as many people as possible could and would participate. So not much teaching and lecturing, but rather discussing on what it is that drives the human beings into taking such decisions and ending in this kind of a setup. I also say this because it just might be that we could be moving towards some kind of a new Cold War situation as we speak. In my view, just to stress this, history does not repeat itself, but it does rhyme. David had a remarkable career in leading the UWC colleges. After it was announced that he would leave Atlantic College in 1982 for his new headmaster role in the Adriatic College, I saw him and asked why did he make this move? He wanted to sum up his response by saying that he felt one needs to do different things in different times of one's career. He felt the Adriatic provided him a different kind of challenge that the Atlantic than the Atlantic College, which was in his home country. And later, later, the way he demonstrated another new spurt of energy in his role for Mostar was very much new again. There's a lot of wisdom in his comment, and I thought about it a lot later on. The view of David Sutcliffe on the role of colleges needing to be part of the community and the society where they are positioned in is very well known to all of us. But he also talked a few times early on about the responsibility of all of us needing to pay back later on in our lives. It did not really resonate very much at the time for me, I have to admit, but I have recalled his words later many, many times. I think this is an area where we UWC alumni today can do a lot more. And this means both supporting the UWC colleagues as well as making sure we as individuals are exemplary citizens wherever we have settled to live by taking the appropriate supporting role as much as we can. This is also very much part of the great legacy of David Sutcliffe. So thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jorma. I love that story about you and your Czech classmate listening to the BBC in the dining hall, basically experiencing history and being able to see it through the eyes of those immediately affected by it. It is one of the most precious things the UWC gave all of us, I think. Now, you experienced David at a relatively early stage and in so many different roles. David was a bit of a Renaissance man anyways, but at the time he was a German teacher. His German was amazing, by the way. I think he corrected my grammar on several occasions. He was a passionate sailor who headed up the AC rescue boat program. And later, of course, as we all know, crossed the Atlantic all by himself, only Leo Tolstoy and William Shakespeare in the boat with him. But David also loved music. I'm told by reliable sources that he himself performed very energetically in a college concert once, playing the cuckoo. My cousin Veronica, who was 9 at the time, told me she was mortified because even though there were only 2 notes, David insisted on playing them in the wrong order. But when he was in the mood for something more sophisticated, he turned to his former students. Luis Perez from Venezuela, our first performer, went to Adriatic College from 97 to 99. Luis now heads up the music program at Dulwich College in London. And it isn't the first time that he performs for David and Elizabeth. He played for them at their 50th wedding anniversary. And today, Luis will play the first movement of Beethoven's piano sonata in A flat major, Opus 110. He described it to me as intense, uplifting, and full of kindness. He said it reminded him of David. Luis, over to you. Thank you. Thank you, Luis. That was very beautiful. And there were passages that were, as you promised, quite intense. David was intense. When he had an idea, he saw what it would look like in his mind, and then he went out there to make it happen. And one of his most ambitious ideas was to open a united world college in Mostar, one of the most divided cities in one of the most divided countries, just a few years after a war. David and Elizabeth had experienced the war in Yugoslavia up close. It was happening just across the border from Duino. Student vans would head to refugee camps on the weekends. And so after he retired from Duino, David had a new project, and it was vintage David. He wanted to show a city that insisted on teaching students from two ethnic groups in two different school systems that you can, in fact, teach kids from 70 countries in one and the same school. In the words of our next speaker, David wanted to mock the division. Lamija Tanović is from Bosnia. She's a nuclear physicist and a former ambassador, but she's also one of the people that worked with David to make the UWC in Mostar a reality. Lamija, over to you.
I forgot to unmute myself. Thank you, Catherine. I must admit that it is extremely difficult to describe David Sutcliffe in a short text or a short speech. It is difficult because David was an extraordinary individual. It would be much easier to write a whole book about him. I could put together an entire volume of his writings from the time when our organization, that was the founder of the college in Mostar, was established. It was called the United World College IBO Initiative in Bosnia-Herzegovina. That was an exciting time when United World College in Mostar was organized, together with other parts of the initiative, such as the teacher training center or the cooperation of three IB schools in Bosnia, the time of the efforts to increase the number of IB schools in our country in the hope that the Bosnian secondary school system could learn something from the IB system. Perhaps in Wales and in Duino, David was a college man who directed all his energies towards the United World Colleges there. In Mostar, David was much more than that. In Mostar, he finally found himself in a place where he could prove his long-standing theory that, especially in regions facing difficult issues, such as Bosnia and Herzegovina, the United World Colleges should be more than elite private schools with an excellent academic program. In Mostar, David was everything: a founder, a member of the initiative executive committee, which was at the same time everything for the college, the president of the fundraising committee, and finally, until the very end of his working life, the chair of the board of directors of our Education in Action Foundation. He achieved fantastic results in Bosnia-Herzegovina under impossible post-war circumstances in the divided city of Mostar, as Catherine said, in the divided, segregated gymnasium. He understood this complicated situation in ways that thousands of other foreigners who lived and worked in Bosnia did not. With David, we managed to overcome many obstacles and to keep the United World College in Mostar alive after the initial three-year pilot phase. For this and for everything that he did in Mostar, we are endlessly grateful. The college is now marking its 15th anniversary, and the foundation has become a recognized organization in Bosnia and in the region through its projects and activities promoting better education in this country. Let me confirm all these valuable ideas by quoting David himself. Here is what he wrote on many occasions. The foremost task of the initiative is to serve Bosnia and the region. The overriding motivation behind the initiative was to respond to the challenges faced by Bosnia and the region of Southeast Europe in the aftermath of the events of the 1990s. The creation of the college in Mostar was an instrument in this effort, not the aim. The college in the original concept is inseparable from the wider goals as represented by the program of professional development for teachers and cooperation with the two schools in Sarajevo and Banja Luka and potentially others to follow. There is no sense in a United World College in Bosnia unless its structure and purpose are carefully tailored to meet Bosnian and regional needs. Nor do I see much chance to secure funding for a stand-alone college. Those were David's words. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Lamija. You know, Mostar's reputation was so good that within only a few years, hardened nationalist leaders from all the ethnic groups suddenly wanted to send their own children there. And one of the most beautiful stories that have come out of Mostar for me is that the daughter of the Croatian nationalist mayor of Mostar fell in love with the son of a prominent Serbian nationalist leader, which caused a bit of a scandal for their families. And once when they were holding hands walking through the town, an old lady scolded them, but these two just stopped and kissed in front of her to show her what peace looks like. It's kind of like the UWC version of Romeo and Juliet, but with a happy ending. They're now at university together. And there are so many love stories that are born at the UWC. Karen Mark from Hong Kong, our next performer, fell in love with a German from her year in Duino at the 10-year reunion. And she says that David knew it before them. "You look good together," he told them casually during the reunion. A year later, they were married. Now, Karen is a real pop star. She's actually having a live concert in Hong Kong as we speak. So to celebrate David, she has recorded a message and a song for him and Elizabeth. Here it is.
Hi, everybody. Good to see you all here on Zoom today. Thank you, Adrian, for organizing this. I'm in the studio with my band here. So we'd like to dedicate a song to you all, and especially Mrs. Sutcliffe. This is a song I wrote several years ago. It's called Number One Fan.
Confin del mare, po.
Lovely. Wow, that was quite an act to follow for our next speaker. Next up is Henry Thomas. Henry, what are you going to sing for David today? No, I'm just kidding. Henry Thomas is a very old friend of David and Elizabeth's. After David took over in Duino, this being Italy, he wanted an art historian on his staff. And so he hired Henry, who ended up running one of the most popular courses ever at the college, World Arts and Cultures. He was in Duino for 17 years until 2012. And Henry is one of four people, three former UWC colleagues and one former student of David, who put together a book after David's death called David Sutcliffe, Pioneer of International Education, His Life, His Words, and His Legacy. It's a wonderful book. I already have my copy, and I strongly encourage everybody to order one. You can basically just contact your UWC, it's for free. And if you don't have a direct affiliation with UWC, you can also contact Mostar, they'll just send you one. I do encourage you to get it. When I called Henry before the event today and asked him what he remembered most about David, he said, "There are many things I can recall about David, and some of them I can't repeat." Who knows? Maybe one day there's a sequel to this book. Until then, Henry, over to you.
Thank you. As we've heard from those who've already spoken today, and as many of you know from your personal experience of him, David Sutcliffe was a remarkable man. He was a visionary and a leader, a charismatic figure without vanity, always a teacher and always willing to learn. His interests were myriad. He was a man of action who sailed single-handedly across the Atlantic in 1976, and importantly, a man of deep reflection, especially about the role of education in a fractured, dangerous, and globalized world. He was a fine writer and speaker, whether crafting the erudite, thought-provoking, and witty speeches he made at college opening and closing ceremonies, reunions of alumni, conferences, the 50th anniversary of the founding Atlantic College, or delivering the memorial address for Alec Peterson, the first Director General of the IBO. He was also the official biographer of his mentor, Kort Hahn. Sadly, David didn't live to complete the biography, but a real sense of it is available in the long chapter on Hahn, that is the core of his book, Kort Hahn, I'm gonna hold it up, and the United World Colleges and Other Founding Figures. This book is a meticulously researched, elegantly written account, uniquely informed by David's friendship and collaboration with not only Hahn, but also many of the other key players in the foundational history of the United World Colleges. So in that book, you'll find Tony Bess, crucial to the creation of Atlantic, Adriatic, and Mostar. Admiral Desmond Hoare, the first headmaster of Atlantic. Corrado Belci, the founding president of UWC Adriatic, and Alec Peterson. However, as many people have noted, it lacks one chapter, a chapter on another founding figure, and that's DBS himself. It is our hope that Andrew McElhose, Pilvi Torsti, Colin Reed, and I, that this book, David Sutcliffe, Pioneer of International Education, will fill that gap. In the course of work on the book, we came across a prescient letter written by Kort Hahn in 1959 about the 24-year-old David Sutcliffe. I'm just going to read you part of what Hahn wrote. "David has quite remarkable gifts as an educator. He has deep human sympathies. He is a thoughtful man of action. I have known few young men with such a sense of responsibility. He's a first-class organizer." You can tick all these things as you think about him. This is my favorite bit. "As yet, he is not a good teacher, but could become an outstanding one once he masters his shyness. His talent for modern languages is exceptional. He is a natural leader." When I first read this, I was immediately struck by Hahn's comment on David's shyness. During the quarter of a century in which I was lucky enough to know him, One thing that always struck me was his essential modesty, his reticence about his own achievements. It was this, I think, that explains why he resisted many requests for an autobiography. So I'm pleased to say that at the heart of the book we have compiled, that's it here, the heart of this book is autobiographical. It is David in his own words. Here you'll find David's insights into the parts played by Hahn and Lord Mountbatten and the beginnings of Atlantic College. You'll also find his own account of the foundation of Adriatic in Duino, in addition to his own contribution, the part played in that by Corrado Belci, but also those other key figures, the late Giorgio Pontoni and Ambassador Gianfranco Facubinetti. Ambassador Facubinetti not only contributed his memories of David to the book, and you'll find them here, but he's also present here online at the moment in Berlin. On page 55 to 56, I'm just going to show it to you. Some of you will recognize this. You can see literally David's first thoughts on the creation of a college in Mostar. This is the document with his annotations. Those of you who are familiar with David's writing will know that the handwriting is difficult to construe, but you know it's from him because it's on blue paper. These first thoughts were was the foundation of the initiative for the Mostar College, an initiative driven by those three musketeers, David, Tony Bess, and one of the authors of this book, Pilvi Torsti. You can also read here his account of the part played by the United World College movement in shaping the IB. And that's a story in which he played a bigger and more important role than many people realize. It was David who, as head of Atlantic, decided to adopt the IB as the only examination. It's quite interesting that there was a generation who did both, who did the experimental group. But it was David who took the choice, made the decision, that IB would be the only examination offered by the college. And thus he gave a crucial backing to that examination. Indeed, at one point, Atlantic College accounted for more than half of the IB candidates in the world. David believed in the IB as an idea and an ideal, and he put belief into action. In 1976, a financial crisis threatened the survival of the IB organization. And David was a key player in organizing financial support for it by schools committed to an internationally accredited examination. From 1977 to 84, David was a member of the IBO Executive Committee, and he was vice chair of the Standing Conference of Heads of IB Schools. From 1985 to 1989, he was the vice president of the IBO Council of Foundation and deputy chair of the IB Executive Committee. I would add that during those years, he was also the rettore of UWC Adriatic. As I've said, David believed in the IB as an idea and an ideal, and as was his credo, he put ideas into action. Belief into action is also at play in David's fascinating and revealing account of his solo voyage across the Atlantic in 1975. You'll find the logbook of that in the book. Like his mentor, Cord Hahn, David believed in the importance of challenge, of testing oneself, in order to discover, as Hahn suggested, you have more in you than you know. The text of that account of his voyage is here in full. We, the compilers, have sought to frame this autobiography, David's speeches, David's writings, with contextual commentary, with a biography of David and his family, and above all, with recollections and reminiscences of those who knew him and worked with him over the course of his life. Crucially, you'll also find here David's thoughts about international education. We present the book not only as both autobiography and biography of DBS, but also as his challenge to the UWC movement. On more than one occasion, David argued that the UWC movement should found colleges, not where they, quote, can be afforded, but where they are needed. That the focus of attention should be on societies torn by war and intercommunal strife, on post-conflict societies like Bosnia-Herzegovina, Several of the articles and speeches gathered in the book touch on this major theme. We, the compilers, offer it not only as a memorial volume and an anthology of David's writings, but also as his voice, as the global UWC movement ponders its future. So with regard to the debate about the future of the UWC, perhaps the movement might consider the foundation of a college which specifically engages with the conflicts of the Middle East. Back in 1995, when I first met David, this was an issue that was being actively discussed. There was talk of a college under the joint patronage of Leah Rabin and Queen Noor of Jordan, but events put paid to that idea. In several conversations I had with David, he sketched an idea for a college in Cyprus. It would be located in a place of intercommunal strife. It would be located close to, but not in, the conflicts of the Middle East. Its history on the ancient trade routes between Mediterranean Europe, the Middle East and Asia along the Silk Road would provide a historical and cultural context in which to understand contemporary tensions. Both Adriatic and Mostar in their time were founded where they were needed by David and others who believed in the transformative power of education. As we remember him here today in words, let's set about memorializing him in deeds by supporting the colleges that he led and founded, and above all, by making the UWC, to quote the phrase, a force to unite nations and cultures for peace and a sustainable future. And I would add, in places where they are needed, but cannot be afforded. Finally, and in her presence online, I want to pay tribute to Elizabeth Sutcliffe, who has been a stalwart supporter of this book, and of whom David wrote the following. None of this would have been possible without Elizabeth. Where would I have been, and how would I have managed without her? From us, the compilers, thank you, Elizabeth, for your support in what we've done. Thank you.
Thank you, Henry. That was a beautiful tribute. And thank you also for that beautiful quote, which is from another remarkable book, a book that David wrote about his German parents-in-law, my grandparents. You know, my cousin Veronica once recounted how at the very first meeting with his oncologist in July 2018, David made it quite clear that he still had another book to write. And of course he did. And that was this family portrait. It's an absolute treasure for our entire family. And it's one of really a handful of things I would grab if there were a fire in the house. Our next performer has also written a remarkable book. Angie Jarouch, a young Syrian writer, came to Mostar as a refugee in 2017. She grew up in war, and she turned that trauma into poetry while she was at the UWC. Her book is called Bluebirds, A Story of Freedom from the Grip of War. And Angie will read us an excerpt now. Go for it, Angie.
I realized I was still muted, sorry. Thank you, Katrin. This story talks about the Syrian war from a boy's perspective. So what he and his family has experienced throughout it, and specifically what ISIS have done to his city, Erika, when they sieged it, attacked it, and captured him, his family, and the neighbors. But after years of war, the boy manages to get help and start the journey of healing in the attempt of overcoming what he experienced. You know, war is, you know, despite how horrible wars are, sometimes they teach us to be much stronger. Wars change the way we look into life and change, it sort of gives us deeper meaning of love and life and changes our perspective of inner freedom. And that's why I chose this passage, because it describes the boy's hopeful perspective of life towards the end of his journey. So this is the boy's own description of what it is like to feel inner peace. Drums are beating within. Those sounds warn not of an imminent war, yet call for a slumber, a deep sleep in the arms of the light and over the clouds in the sky. I feel I am flying without weight. as if someone has given me a solid shelf on which I could lay all my burdens. I am soaring far beyond the black smoke, deaf noise, blinding lights, and Earth's tall buildings too. I am soaring towards a safe home, which remains with me wherever I go. It is as if space has become my homeland, and my home a sun in the daylit sky or a moon in the dead of the night. How vast space is! Neither buildings nor fences exist. I sense the light surrounding me, moving in and out of my palm, and I feel my soul has found itself. My knees are implanted in the depth of the soil, like the roots of an ancient olive tree, and my palms lounged over them, face up like a sunflower. Thank you.
Thank you, Angie. That was very moving. Angie's book was recently published in Arabic. It's now been translated into English. She's looking for a publisher. I think we should all keep our ears out, if you know anyone in the UWC spirit. You know, it struck me as I was looking at today's lineup of speakers and performers that out of 12, 8 are women. I never really thought of my uncle as a feminist or as someone who might identify with that term. But David was in fact always a champion of women, even when it wasn't so fashionable. Henry Thomas, whose wife Debbie was David's longest serving deputy, told me that David promoted a lot of women in the 1990s. And of course, under him, generations of strong women have graduated from the UWC. We just heard from one, and we're about to hear from another. There are few people that I know who embody the spirit of the UWC better than Chrystia Freeland, a Ukrainian-Canadian who studied in Italy, married a Brit, and lived in several countries, including the former Soviet Union and America. The first time I met Chrystia, she was deputy editor of the FT. I had just graduated and was seeing her for a job interview. I remember being pretty nervous when I walked into her office, but there she was, sitting cross-legged and barefoot on the sofa. And her first question to me, looking at my CV, was, "Oh, you went to the UWC." We barely touched on European politics. Job that day, we basically reminisced about what we both agreed was the single most formative experience in our lives. David came up in that interview too. Chrystia basically said that he and Elizabeth were hugely influential on her life. And Chrystia, of course, did what David always urged his former students to do. She went into politics. And today, she's the Deputy Prime Minister of Canada. She would have been here in person had it not been for that other international gathering today, the G7. But she prepared a video greeting for David and Elizabeth, which we will play for you now.
Ciao, I'm Chrystia Freeland, and I'm so grateful for the opportunity to be here with you to celebrate the life and legacy of a wonderful man, our former teacher and friend, David Sutcliffe. I think David would be very proud of the way we have gathered here today, virtually some of us, from all over the world. I'm so grateful for my 2 years at Collegio del Mondo Unito del Adriatico. And I am so grateful to David and Elizabeth for founding our school. David was fundamentally an optimist and an idealist. He was committed to the UWC movement, to the idea that we are stronger when we work together. That vision has never been more important than it is today as we battle this global pandemic. By continuing to enrich bright young minds with international experiences, the UWC movement is contributing to a better future for us all. That's because young people are our future leaders. Grazie ancora una volta, un piacere d'essere con voi oggi.
So we've just heard from a deputy prime minister, we've had a writer and a pop star and a former CEO, and just give you an idea of the amazing commitment and talent in this virtual room, we have over 800 people registered. And at the moment, I think we're close to 500 actually signed and enlisting. There's staff from several colleges here, people like Adam Thomas from Mostar. There's a whole range of former heads like Andrew Bennett from the UWC Singapore. There are former UW chairs like Gianfranco Bonetti from Adriatic, who was a good friend of David's, and so many former students who've gone on to change the world in ways big or small. There are teachers, doctors, artists, journalists, activists. We have participants from over 60 countries. There's even a former Japanese student from the UWC in Singapore who is sending his greetings from outer space. He's an astronaut and currently at the International Space Station. And talking of outer space, there's one other student who went on to become an astronaut. There are probably several, but there's one other on this call that I know of, Grat Payet. And she sent such a lovely message ahead of the time that, with her permission, I want to read it to you. Grat was at AC during the first flight of a US space shuttle on the 12th of April, 1981. She watched it with fellow students, packed like sardines, as she writes, in the one room at AC that had a television then. It was no doubt an important moment for her, but she writes about another one that was perhaps even more important. So I quote, David Sutcliffe was the first sailing instructor that took me out on the channel in a sailboat on one of these terribly gusty, windy days with unruly seas that we all became so familiar with. The thing is, I was a beach rescue type and I didn't think this was a big deal at first until we got out there. David Sutcliffe told me to strap myself into the trapeze and to follow his instructions to the letter. I drank a fair amount of the Bristol's water that day, but it taught me to respect the outside environment, to trust experience, invest effort in one's training, and to work as a team, always. This anecdote summed up who David Sutcliffe was, Grat says, a man who had vision and compassion, who could run a college, then take a student out on a sailboat on a rough sea with a grin on his face, enjoying every moment of both. Now, I told you we have an impressive lineup of women here today. Next in line is Pilvi Torsti, and it's hard to choose the best way to introduce her. She is a Secretary of State for the Finnish government. She is David's former student in Duino. She is a Bosnia expert who was intimately involved in creating Mostar College with David. And as Henry already mentioned, she's one of the people who put together the book, David's Life and Legacy. I hear there's actually an important election in Finland tomorrow, but Pilvi cut short campaigning just to be here with us today and celebrate David. Pilvi, over to you.
Thank you, Katrin. Dear Saki family, dear all friends of David. All three colleges where David had a critical founding role, Atlantic, Adriatic and Mostar, have now been part of our program. We've heard also Henry's summary of the book on David and his thinking. So it's my privilege as an Adriatic graduate and a Bosnia Mostar project co-founder and co-compiler of the book to bring a future-oriented call for action message to this event. I have three calls, all of which will be explained through David. The first call, we must continue to bring people together. 20 years ago, I was expecting my former headmaster David and his French friend Antonin Bess in the war-torn Sarajevo airport, which had been next to the front line just 5 years before. Most buildings around us were ruined, and there were signs warning about mines just everywhere. Quote, "We are too old men for it that UWC will remain a movement. That is why we are here." End of the quote. Tony Bess explained. That is how David brought three of us together. When David came to Finland to work on Bosnia issues, his former student, and that time the CEO of the huge global company Nokia, Jorma, who we heard earlier today, Jorma insisted to spend half of his Sunday, and that was a Mother's Day actually in Finland, to invite David and some selected people over. That shows that David had unusual human ability to connect with people and also respect all people, even if there was no common language, like it was with my fireman father or my landlady in Sarajevo. David had access to Nobel laureates, car drivers, and cleaning ladies. That respect for all people made it possible for him to get so much done. People wanted to help him. So our first call is bring people together. second call. We must dare to have fundamental influence on other people. David dared to express his views. When we last met, David had just a few weeks left. As we departed in his garden, he whispered to me a note on Boris Johnson to be delivered to the Finnish Prime Minister as Finland was the EU president. It was not a positive note. But more seriously, David, although being a very strict and serious Mr. Sutcliffe to many of us during our student or teacher years, he touched people's lives on fundamental and personal level. We could read that when over 1,000 people joined the Facebook group remembering David Sutcliffe. We remember our end of year reports, blue notes, and also private conversations. For me professionally, most important was a comment he made when we once dined in Sarajevo. I am happy with all the things UWC graduates have done. The only disappointment is that so few are in politics. That comment of David was key to me. And a year later, David wrote a first support to my election. So the second call, we must dare to have fundamental influence on other people. Third call, we must turn the unusual laws into unusual action valid after 100 years. Why many of us have missed David so much? I was actually wondering that myself when we were working on the mentioned book. I believe one misses David the way one was with David. What David made you to be or to do in his presence. Always a little bit more somehow to be best part of yourself. We miss how we were with David. David also made most unusual things. When I challenged him over lunch in Duino Dama Bianca of his speech to bring international education where it is needed but cannot be afforded, as Henry quoted, it took only some 4 hours for him to present that blue paper of UWC Mostar, the first draft. When he needed critical startup funding for Bosnia, he persuaded Tony Bess to underwrite our budget. Quote, he was not happy, but he did, David reported the situation. So I think now we must challenge ourselves to act without having David's advice and encouragement to call upon. We must carry on David's vision and update it. We must make the book widely known. We must continue to act. The perspective of our action should be 100 years. What can we do that is valid after 100 years? There are now two structures through which we have committed to continue David's work. The UWC Mostar Endowment for those who need but cannot afford, and Foundation Education in Action to have wider educational impact. Group of us has committed to the endowment and foundation, and we invite you all to join. Third call, we must turn the unusual loss into action valid after 100 years. And here you see what happened in Mostar. Thank you.
Thank you, Pilvi. And in the spirit of making things valid for 100 years, we have an extraordinary performance coming up now by 10 members of the Atlantic College Choir between 1972 and 1976. It's not quite 100 years, it's 50 years ago when they were singing at a time when David and Elizabeth were in St. Donat's. They have reunited, especially for this occasion, and despite all the difficulties imposed by the pandemic, have rehearsed and recorded two pieces for us today. The first is In Stiller Nacht by Brahms. It is a lament over David's departure. It describes the sorrow of nature, how the moon and stars stop shining, the birds stop singing, and even the wild animals grieve among the rocks and ravines. The second is a 16th century song by Morley called Now is the Merry Month of Maine. This one is about renewal, laughter, and love. It's cheeky, and something the singers agree would have put a smile on David's face. Here's the Atlantic College Choir, 50 years after.
In Stiller Nacht.
I absolutely love this. And just looking at the comments, I think everybody else did too. What a fitting tribute to David. And what an amazing tribute to the power of UWC friendships, which, as we all know, last decades. And even when they lie dormant for half a century, they can just be revived in an instant. And I think that's probably the greatest superpower of the UWC. Our next speaker certainly has superpowers, or at least his students think so. They call him the Messiah. Laurence Nodder is the headmaster of the Robert Bosch UWC in Germany. He was principal of the UWC Waterford before and is the only current UWC head whose tenure overlapped with David's. I remember a conversation with David a couple of years ago in London after Laurence had taken over at the Bosch College. And David told me about his frustration about how some UWCs had become too commercial, how the proportion of scholarships to paying students wasn't right anymore, and how he worried about the movement losing sight of his core public service mission, as he saw it, you know, to deliver great education on merit and need and not the ability to pay. I asked him which of the colleges was truest to these ideals today, and he didn't hesitate. He said it was the Bosch College, and that that had everything to do with the man who ran it. Laurence, over to you.
Thank you, Catherine. Thank you. When I think of David, I remember many things. Elizabeth, my wife Debbie, and I remember the welcome and introduction to UWC you and David gave us as UWC rookies back in May 1999. I remember David drawing our attention to the dull roar of NATO bombers flying overhead on their way to Kosovo, speaking also of individual students whose families were under siege. On getting a sense of the hours that David spent in office, being available, engaging with people, even with your identity as a teacher and tutor, Elizabeth, I remember contemplating your patience, wondering whether you grew lonely. Debbie and I marveled at your mutual commitment and sense of duty. I remember David saying how once a month he would go through his inbox to check that he had responded to all emails that had been received, and not return home until that task was complete. There appeared to be few filters between David and those who sought to engage with him. I remember David speaking at the 2000 UWC Council meeting, Pearson College, what would now be called a UWC Congress. While I cannot remember exactly what he said, I still remember that I considered it impressive, of substance, carrying intellectual weight. When rereading some of David's speeches and his writing, there never is any doubt that David is giving us something substantial to chew on, whether in the end we agree with him or not. At the international board meeting preceding the 2000 UWC Council meeting, I had taken an emotional stand against the full scholarship policy being propounded by David and Jim Coutts, not only for Adriatic and Pearson colleges, but as an articulated aspiration for all UWCs. Coming from the Global South, I had been taken aback by what I perceived as the relative luxury of Waterford cum Clava and of the other UWCs I had visited, certainly in comparison with the schools I had taught in and led prior to Waterford cum Clava. But importantly, David and I shared the common aspiration of selection of students solely on merit. In the context of Robert Bosch College, and what Katrin said in her introduction, I should add that this principle was established by its founders, Christoph Bosch, Jens Woltermann, and Christian Hodeiger, and the long-term funding secured long before my appointment. Arising from the disagreement around the principle of full scholarships, David and I entered into correspondence where we discussed the challenges with the institutionalization of individual UWCs. Into this correspondence crept the idea of caravan UWCs, the idea that UWC might insert itself temporarily into a situation where its very presence might have a strong impact for as long as its presence might be needed. Several in UWC were puzzled by David's early insistence that UWC Mostar should be developed with the concept of a finite lifespan. Given our discussions, I was not. I think we all agree that the circumstances in Bosnia continue to make compelling the case for UWC Mostar. One of David's last summers as Rettore of Adriatic College, the UWC heads gathered in Duino for a retreat. We pondered what we considered a shift in the general student motivation for coming to a UWC, which we perceived increasingly aligned towards the primary objectives of gaining admission into excellent universities, coupled with a UWC community experience. I remember David commenting that the students in the Adriatic College's first generation did not even know at the point of their enrollment that their qualification would be recognized by the Italian authorities. Out of these summer discussions arose the idea of a third year option, without really the option part of it, that students only graduate from UWC, at least in a formal sense, once they had demonstrated their commitment to society through a year of voluntary service, either between their first and second DP years or after the completion of their second year. While some UWCs did try to introduce a year of voluntary service, difficulties with insurances and other considerations sadly made this an idea too late for our time. I remember David noting that Atlantic College's achievements in the 1960s had happened just in time, that current health and safety regulations would have made these impossible. I have been fortunate in knowing and working with a handful of people who I consider as great heads, as giants within this vocation. Each has been a person of vision. Each has been tenacious to the point of personal sacrifice in the realization of their vision, although they probably would deny the sacrificial bit. And each has demonstrated an interest in and care for their students as individuals, young people with their own histories, stories, journeys, and aspirations. David is in that handful. Today we walk in the footsteps of a giant. Thank you.
Thank you, Laurence. You know, can I just say, for me as a German, there's something quite moving about the fact that 80 years after David was on that sailing boat off the coast of Guernsey, listening to the announcement that Europe was now at war, and 60 years after he first started at Atlantic College with the mission to prevent something like that war from happening again, that Germany now has its own UWC. There's something quite redemptive in that. Now, as Laurence said, David was a giant in his profession, a visionary man, a man of the ideas who was respected by his peers. But what made him special was that he was also the guy who repaired the rescue boats and made a fool of himself in school plays quite gladly. And as Augusta from Lucca and Campania, our next performer, can attest to, played that cuckoo in Haydn's Toy Symphony in 1974. Now, Augusta, I don't know if it was because of or despite of David's cuckoo playing that you went into a musical career. You won't be playing the cuckoo for us today, but the harpsichord, which is a slightly more complex instrument. And you've chosen to perform a 17th century song by an Italian composer, which apparently was very popular at the time. Here is Amarilli by Giulio Caccini in an arrangement by Peter Phillips. Thank you, Augusta. That was really lovely. And now, last but certainly not least, we're coming to our distinguished speaker, Princess Sawrat Al-Hassan of Jordan. Princess Sawrat is a former UWC director and was a personal friend of David, whom she described to me as her pen pal. They corresponded for years. Sometimes her kittens would run across the keyboard and David would receive gibberish, but mostly they traded serious ideas about the future of the IB and the UWC. Please welcome Princess Sawrat.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's rather daunting being the last speaker, so much has already been said. I feel I'll be repeating much of what's been said, but here goes. We are here virtually in this rather strange world we seem to live in today to honor the memory of David Sutcliffe. David was a visionary in matters educational, a much loved headmaster and rettore, a guide to many when they were young and callow, that so many of his former students here and elsewhere have acknowledged the debt they owe him is a wonderful legacy. An inspiration and mentor to many, he was also a doer who got things done and rarely took no for an answer. And he was a very good and loyal friend. Our friendship dates back to 1990. I had recently been asked to get involved in the United World Colleges by the Prince of Wales with a view to introducing the concept in the Middle East. Apart from Prince Charles, in those days, I knew no one involved in the movement except Robert Blackburn, who had been International Secretary of the United World Colleges, who, but by this time, had moved on to be Deputy Director General of the IBO. David had been Vice President of the IB Council of Foundation, of which I was a member, and so I'd met him briefly in that context, but could not say I knew him as such. He and his good friend, Tony Best, were legendary figures in the annals of both United World College and the International Baccalaureate. Both organizations that might not have survived their principal but financially shaky starts had it not been for these two men who together and in their different ways stepped in to salvage the situation on more than one occasion, both morally and materially. So there I was in Trieste, feeling rather out of place. Everyone knew each other and was bustling around in a rather self-important manner. Prince Charles was of course kind, but too busy. At which point, David and Tony stepped into the breach and swept me up, and I felt at home. The United World College movement and the IB had both been created in the post-World War II years. Kurt Hahn, who had founded first a school at Zalim and then at Gordonston, started the United World College movement with Atlantic College in 1962, as he said. During a visit to NATO Defense College in Paris, inspired by the camaraderie he witnessed amongst men who had been adversaries not long before, Hahn felt that this spirit should be harnessed and built upon in future generations, and so Atlantic College was born. A few years later, Lord Mountbatten, who very much identified with the United World College and served as international president from 1968 to 1977, believed that there was a pressing need for the college to be cloned and to expand its horizons beyond Europe and North America, both in the location of the colleges and in the makeup of the student body. Today, there are some 19 colleges spread across the world. Alex Peterson, the founder and main inspiration behind the IB, firmly believed after his experiences during the war that, and I quote, international mindedness was crucial. It has a lot to do with maintaining peace between nations. David absolutely shared this thinking and so gave all the support he could to the new and innovative system of education. It was first trialed at Gordonston, where he taught after Zalim. Later, he was to use Atlantic College, where he was a director, as almost a lab school where ideas and methods could be developed and honed. And the IB saw the light of day and it took off. I was behind the founding of the first IB college in Jordan some 40 years ago. Although regarded with deep suspicion by the powers that be within the traditional Jordanian educational bodies, and indeed the region, the Amman Baccalaureate School has succeeded. The IB has taken root and has been the impetus behind the inevitable change in approach to education within the country. People had sat up and noticed that many of the principles of the IB could only enrich a national curriculum. These ideas were duly included in the 10-year Jordanian educational reform project, which started in 1987 and have now been in many instances implemented. So today, not only are there over 20 IB schools within Jordan, but we have in our small way been a catalyst for change in the Arab world. The ABS was the driving force behind the creation of an IB syllabus for the teaching of the history and culture of the Islamic world and also Arabic. I have complained there was not much international about the IB when neither Arabic, nor for that matter, Chinese, Turkish, or Persian were examined at language A level. And these two were then duly included. There was a time when the ABS was regarded as a source and fount of wisdom by many educationists in the region. And even today, to have worked there is considered an impeachable recommendation. But now we are largely seen as the elder statesman of such schools, and there are many new kids on the block with many new ideas. When I used to sometimes fret that our positive influence was being curbed, David sought to reassure me, reminding me of his words in Duino in 2010. We must all be conscious of the classical fate of progressive schools. They are founded to advocate and to demonstrate educational reform as a matter of principle. If unsuccessful, they disappear and are forgotten. And if successful, their ideas are absorbed into the mainstream. Oops. I think I have lost a page. Hang on a minute, everyone. Sorry, this is very, very inefficient of me.
No problem.
I don't know what's happened. Oh, my Lord. Anyway, let me go on. And if it doesn't make sense, just shout at me. The ideals for both concepts, the United World Colleges and the IB, were perfectly in tune with David's own belief in the sort of education that impressionable young people could and would benefit from. It is therefore not surprising that he threw himself into supporting and working with both heart and soul. With a keen intellect, as well as being a superb athlete, David was a perfect example of mensana in corpore sano, and as such was ideally positioned to champion these new and innovative ideas of education. Not only was he a Cambridge graduate, but he was also a rugby blue, and successfully took part in 1976 in the Observer's single-handed transatlantic raid, arriving safe and sound some 46 days later in Newport, Rhode Island. He had managed to read all of Shakespeare's plays, War and Peace, and I'm told much else on the way to while away the lonely hours. It is therefore no surprise that it was with equal amounts of verve and conviction that he set about developing the various physical activities that flourished at Atlantic College under his stewardship and which continue to this day. A very proficient surf canoeist himself, he merged the canoe lifeguard unit with the beach guard's lifeguard into the surf life-saving unit. And this in the inshore lifeboat station are to this day a landmark of United College. But these initiatives were not at the expense of other equally vital aspects of the IB program. David gave strong support to Museum of the Arts, overseeing the redevelopment of a local arts center to benefit not just pupils of the college, but also for a youth training scheme for unemployed young people. A great believer in giving opportunities to disadvantaged youth, long before it was the buzzword that it is today, it was to inform the ways and means by which David ran both Atlantic College and later Adriatic. One such initiative at Atlantic some 40 years ago was the introduction of a summer program for the extramural department, which welcomed scores of young people, mostly groups from inner cities, to the college during the long holidays, with former and present students running most of the activities. It was typical of David that on retirement after 19 years at Duino, he undertook what was perhaps the most challenging of the educational tasks of his career. The labors of Hercules seem almost a doddle compared to what he undertook to get United World College at Mostar up and running. In his late 60s by then, he might well have been excused if he'd slept into a comfortable retirement with Elizabeth, writing, sailing, and so on, but that would not have been David. Seeing the carnage in the Balkans and in its aftermath, he asked if there were not a real need for the United World Colleges to contribute after the cessation of conflict to the rebuilding of civic society on the ground. Are we right within the United World College to sense a renewed need for an idealistic target that might initially seem to be beyond our grasp? Is there not a real risk for international education societies struggling to regain their balance after conflicts, the roots of which are still present? Suffice to say that David involved Tony Best and Pilvi Torsti. They called themselves the Three Musketeers, if you have heard. And amazingly, and against great odds, the college saw light of day in 2006. The years passed since 1990 in Trieste. I saw Tony frequently, as his wife, Christiane, were Paris-based and more accessible. But I usually only heard of David rather than saw him. There was one happy reunion when he was on a tour of the region and came to Jordan for a few days. Our paths finally crossed in 2017, when we were both asked to give an address at Tony Bess's memorial at St. Anthony's in Oxford. By then, David and Elizabeth were living in Sussex, and so we were finally able to meet socially a few times. Wheels within wheels and 6 degrees of separation and all that, we found that we had friends in common. David had lost touch with the Badens, Princess Max and Ludwig, whose father in Kortan had founded the school at Salem in Germany, where he had lived and worked and met Elizabeth. Consequently, he was pleased and surprised to meet up with Ludwig in our garden in London. He was also pleased to meet Val Arnold Forster, whose father-in-law had been instrumental in setting up Gordonston. But most of this time, I was in Jordan and David was in the UK. So you could say that actually we became pen pals, and our friendship flourished over a regular exchange of emails on all sorts of topics, together with the occasional telephone call. Elizabeth's sister was deeply involved in supporting Palestinian refugees, and naturally this struck a chord with my husband and myself, and we were able to exchange information that would be beneficial all round. I would forward articles and interviews on this and other topical issues by my husband and others, and this also prompted long discussions back and forth. When he fell ill, David passed it off quite lightly, slipping in comments about how the treatment was going in answer to my queries, and returned swiftly to whatever we were discussing. That year, my daughter was also diagnosed with cancer, and I was deeply concerned about her, and I regret to say I became erratic in my correspondence, but was reassured when he told me that things were going well, until one day the emails just stopped, and then the mobile was not answered. I then heard from Adrian how very ill David actually was. Sadly, we never spoke or communicated again, and I feel the loss of his friendship and wide counsel so often. Something which concerned David hugely and has been touched upon by others, and me in my small way, and about which we both expended many emails in those last few months, was our concern that the raison d'être, the philosophy behind both the United World College and the IB were being slowly eroded. Both organizations had become very big, and we're in danger of losing that personal touch that was so important. The new kids on the block that I had mentioned were also there, flexing their muscles and their new ideas in both organizations. When David was rector at Adriatic, he took huge pride in the fact that every single student who joined the college came on a full scholarship, with him securing financial assistance from the Italian government and companies and industries. Years that I headed the Jordanian National Committee, I took a leaf out of his book and nagged and bullied scholarships wherever and whenever I could. Together, only two colleges, as far as I am aware, fully fund all their students, Mostar and the Robert Bosch United World College. The others mainly offer partial scholarships, if at all. Often it is merely a totally unsponsored place, which in the case of a country like Jordan, inevitably means that a whole swathe of bright young people can never aspire to go to a United World College, as even 40 or 50% of the fees is beyond their means. This surely is a negation of what was originally intended, that the brightest and the best should get a chance to benefit from a United World College education, irrespective of their financial background. The IB too has changed beyond recognition. When I first got involved, there were some 120 plus schools worldwide. Today, I believe there are 5,000 plus and growing. I rest my case. The system of examinations has been changed, particularly for languages and visual art. And again, some of us ask ourselves if this is for the best. Schools are being licensed, which in no shape or form follow the true parameters of what an IB school should offer, not just in academic terms, but if I can use the term in spirit. The IB diploma risks becoming just another school leaving qualification. That said, the IB still continues to offer one of the best systems of education in the world, encompassing the nurturing of the whole child in such a way that they can take the initiative, deploy critical thinking, and fulfill their potential and contribute to society in whatever their chosen field. Today, as countries begin to emerge, albeit at different speeds, from the horrors of this pandemic, perhaps it is a moment for reflection and reset, not back to some non-existent golden age, but forwards and onwards to fulfilling David's vision based on Hans Petersen and his own philosophy of the best possible education for our young people, always underpinned by strong and moral ethical views. But there is no doubt that even if things are not quite what you'd want them to be, the success of both United World Colleges and the IB over these past 50 to 60 years is due in no small measure to David Sutcliffe, to his passion, and sheer hard work. He was an exceptional man whose life was gentle and the elements so mixed in him that nature might stand up and say to all the world, this was a man. And might I add, he was jolly good looking. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much, Princess Sarvat. We all miss David. I still see him sitting on the sofa in Linfield just a few weeks before his death. He was physically weak, but there he was, cracking jokes about his recent haircut and then proceeding to talk about history and politics and life all afternoon. He was as full of wit and wisdom as ever. This is how I will remember him. And David lives on in his children, in his grandchildren, in his words, in the colleges he helped to build, and in all of you who have taken inspiration from him and carry his values into the world. This year, the David and Elizabeth Sutcliffe Endowment Fund awarded its first scholarship to Dominik Matsukovic from Belarus. Dominik is 17. He led the strike committee at a school during last year's protests. He eventually had to flee the country to escape a prison sentence. He will go to Mostar in August. I now want to give the final word to my Aunt Elizabeth, who was by David's side for 60 years, and as David himself acknowledged, everything he achieved with her. Thank you.
Thank you, Catherine. I'm extremely grateful to Her Royal Highness Princess Sarvat for her moving contribution, which we have just heard, and for taking the time to be with us today. Thank you, Princess Sarvat. I would also like to say a few words on behalf of the Sutcliffe family. Our son Michael, daughter Veronica, and I were really touched when we heard about the idea of having such an occasion in David's honor. As he died before the beginning of the pandemic, it was planned as a live event, which we would all have preferred. Fortunately, there is the Zoom alternative. I'm immensely grateful that so many people contributed to making it happen and to producing the book, David Sutcliffe, Pioneer of International Education, with texts by and about David. It is a beautiful publication, and we are quite overwhelmed. So a huge thank you to the organizers, speakers, and performers of this event, the authors and contributors of the book, and all the people who, over many decades, have made David's and my life so interesting. Many of you have known David for only 2 years, some for much longer. I have been fortunate to have shared almost 60 years with him. From the very beginning, these years were dominated by the United World Colleges. But this has always been an enthralling, fulfilling, sometimes challenging domination. As you all know, life around David was never dull. Even long into his retirement, until his illness stopped him, he continued to have new, always original ideas. And then he persuaded people to help him make them a reality. I am proud to have seen all this happen and to have played a small part in it. This sometimes meant bringing David back to earth when his ideas were too high up in the clouds. We certainly appreciated living in fantastic places and being surrounded by students, inviting them in St. Donat's to our weekly open house and in Duino to the monthly tutorial dinners, cooked in our kitchen by students using recipes and often even ingredients from many different countries. Interestingly, the recipes came more often from grandmothers than from mothers or fathers. And then there were the colleagues and the visiting speakers who came to dinner. I cannot imagine any other circumstances in which we could have personally met so many different fascinating people. One even invited us to the Nobel Prize ceremonies in Stockholm one year, where we met remarkable personalities and took part in magnificent festivities. In the colleges, it was not easy to have a private life. In Atlantic College, we could see every single student day room from our house. This was good for the headmaster to keep a watchful eye on everyone, but it also worked the other way. Family life was important to both of us. Therefore, we had to make use of the long summer holidays with the children and later on our own. There were wonderful weeks sailing on the Adriatic Sea or walking in the mountains, undisturbed, no mobile phones then, and we could talk, read, and relax. In retirement back in Britain, David adored our grandchildren, with whom he played football, pored over jigsaw puzzles, romped on the floor, and shared jokes, much more than he had ever had time for with his children. They called him a legend and will certainly remember their granddad. Thank you again to all those who made this meeting possible, who contributed to the book, and to everyone who is listening and watching. Although David would be too modest to admit it, he would secretly be proud of this event. Thank you.
I think we're going to see a slideshow now, and then anyone who wants to hang around and do some socializing with past friends, go for it. I think the event is now formally over, but you can keep going for as long as you'd like.
Thank you. Wole, wole. Abdu Jambar, wole. Nyari balai kala, wole. Jikau lai joge, wole. Tanu sisaro, wole. Munila, wole. Degam julinga, wole. Munila, wole. Degam worga, wole.
Wole, wole, wole.